The name of this video is Volume Polarization Charge Part 1. In fact, in the previous video, we qualitatively understood the meaning of the surface polarization charge sigma p in presence of a uniform external field in R. So we saw that it's easy to understand that there is such a charge sigma p, which is equivalent, describes a distribution of dipoles and is a physical quantity. What about rho p? Rho p is much more complicated to grasp, to understand. And so how do we do that? We consider again a point capital Q in the neighborhood of which we have a volume delta V, exactly as we have seen in the previous video. Again, the volume is indicated here in 2Ds, in two dimensions, for simplicity. So this is my point capital Q. There are n, capital N molecules inside this volume delta V. Okay, so we know from local neutrality that no matter what, with or without an inducing external field in R, we know that it has to be that rho plus the positive charge distribution density in the neighborhood of point capital Q plus rho minus in the neighborhood of point capital Q at this sum, local neutrality has always to be zero because the molecules are each neutral. And again, I have capital N molecules in this object, all right, in this volume. So my point capital Q is therefore associated with the volume delta V. And what are the positive charges and what are the total negative charges? The total positive and the total negative charges associated with this volume? Well, we need to use this charge neutrality condition. We eventually will use it. But for now, let's only split these charges into capital delta Q plus and capital delta Q minus. So what are capital delta Q plus and capital delta Q minus? Well, by definition of rho, capital delta Q plus has to be rho plus around point capital Q in the neighborhood of that point times the volume delta V. So remember that each molecule is comprised of a positive and negative charge. And so the density of the positive charges times delta V is the overall positive charge of all the capital N molecules in this volume. And this one is going to be rho minus around capital Q times capital delta V in this fashion. Okay? All right. So now, let us suppose that we do polarize our volume here. And so how do we polarize it? Well, we switch on some external field E naught. So this means we polarize the system. Great. So now that we polarize the system, delta V happens to be associated with what? Even if originally the solid was made from non-polar molecules, once we polarize them, it's going to be polarized and therefore is going to be characterized by the capital delta P electric dipole moment, the overall electric dipole moment of capital delta V, the volume. And so what is this quantity? Well, we can use the simple definition of electric dipole moment, which we know is given by the positive charge, that is in this case capital delta Q plus. It has to be a vector, and so it has to be times L, where L vector is the distance between the positive and negative charges, oriented from the negative to the positive charge. That's exactly what we get. So what about delta Q plus? Well, we know that delta Q plus is rho plus times delta V, and so this quantity happens to be rho plus at point capital Q times L vector times delta V. Great. So now let's remind ourselves that, as it turns out, from the physics of the problem, we know that the cubic root of capital delta B is much larger than L norm, and at the same time, we know that rho plus as well as rho minus, they are very large. That is, the product is constant, as it happens here, so we are considering a large set, an Avogadro number set of quasi-ideal dipoles, electric dipoles. All right, so now that we know all that, we can define, in the same fashion as we did when we consider a distribution of dipoles mathematically many videos ago, we can define something which we already did in the previous video, I'm repeating it one more time, repetita juvant, that is, repeating helps in Latin, capital P, the polarization vector, in the at this point, capital Q, okay, which again is part of a bigger solid, let's say a homogeneous solid, for example, this we know that by means of physics infinitesimal elements is given by delta P, as computed up here, divided by delta B in that neighborhood of point capital Q. Well, now we can actually compute it more in detail compared to what we did before. Before, we only defined it. What is delta P? Delta P is nothing but rho plus L delta B. Divided by delta B, this gives us rho plus point by point at point capital Q. It's a point by point function, it's a density. It has to be a vector times L vector. It's a vector density instead of a scalar density, like the charge rho is a scalar density. This is a vector density. And it's the polarization vector in this specific example. Now, at this point, as I already said, purely from theory, we could, without resorting to any intuition, to any qualitative physical understanding of this problem, from theory, we could simply remind ourselves that, remember that sigma equivalent, remember from those videos, it was defined as the funny capital P vector dotted with N, which in the specific case of the dielectric materials and molecules is going to be capital P as defined here, dotted with N. Similarly, rho equivalent, which back then we define as minus the divergence with respect to the coordinate prime of funny P, in this case is going to be given by minus the divergence of capital P vector. If you trust these calculations, which of course are correct, you can stop right there and the problem is solved. You know what is your sigma P and you know what is your sigma, your rho P. So this one is my sigma P and this one is my rho P. And you would be done. Sigma P, at least we gave some physics intuition. Yes, we did that in the previous example. What about rho P? We want to understand that there is such a thing as rho P. In order to understand that, it's much more complicated. And so how do we proceed? Let's consider again our generic, this is part of a generic homogeneous object. So let's do it like this. This is my object, the capital omega. In this object, I establish an external field in at, let's say for example, somewhere in this region of space, in at points in this direction. It can be non-uniform, it can be whatever you want. It's my polarizing field, polarization field. All right, so now within the object, I'm going to consider a small volume, an infinitesimally small volume, which is realized by means of a slanted cylinder. Now, I know the students always have problems with this. Why does he want to use a slanted cylinder? The reason you could use a regular cylinder. The reason why I want to use a slanted cylinder is because it allows me to orient it along the direction of the field lines in knot while keeping the most general problem you can get, because there is an angle, which I will define now, which allows you to make the problem very general in a simple geometrical fashion. So again, you could use a regular cylinder, but slanted is much, much better because L is parallel on average, except for the jittering, to E naught. And so let's consider a slanted cylinder of this fashion. So the one face of the cylinder, now here I attempt to do it in 3D. So this is one face of the cylinder in 3D. Then I do the, so this is like, if I would look at the cross section, it would just look like this, straight up. And I follow then with the lateral surface of the cylinder, the fill lines of E-naught in this fashion. So here I keep following the fill lines of E-naught in this fashion. So down here, eventually I will have the other, so let's do it like this. This is the other surface of the cylinder. Right here somewhere in the middle, or some, it doesn't have to be in the middle, somewhere here we will have an internal, I show an internal cross-sectional area like this. The reason why I'm not doing the middle, because remember that when I polarize molecules, L plus and L minus don't have to be necessarily the same. And so this surface here, I choose it to be centered around the overall center of charge Q, which was the cross in the first video of this series, okay? Whereas the full dot and the neg and the open dot were the center of charges of the positive and negative charges, so this can be off-center. This area, let's call it, for example, let's just call it delta A or dA, if you want. Let's call it delta A. So this area here, it's a small area, delta A. The reason why I like delta, capital delta, because it comes from a delta V, okay? So it's fast, it's physics infinitesimal element, okay? That's, it could be a dA if you go in the limit eventually. And the normal unit vector at this point here, this space is like this, and so the normal unit vector goes exactly in this direction. So this is the normal unit vector N at this surface. And if you continue this vector here, you will notice that eventually it forms an angle, which I call theta with E naught. If this theta was zero, then I would be a trivial case when somehow N is parallel to E naught. Whereas by means of this landed cylinder, I can choose this N to have an angle theta with E naught while keeping the lateral segment, this lateral surface of the cylinder to be parallel to E naught. So this landed cylinder is a very good construction because it allows me to consider the most generic, a generic theta case between N and E naught. And yet it allows me to have the lateral surface to be parallel to the line, the field lines of E naught. You could do the same with a regular cylinder, it's just much more complicated in my opinion. So I will not do that, but you can try to do that. All right. So now, remember again, this is my point Q, is basically this point here, it's the same, okay? So I'm zooming, I'm looking at this, it's the same object. All right. So now let's zoom in and let's look at this slanted cylinder. So let me just write it down here. So this, so we don't forget. You can also look up at the geometry of a slanted cylinder, for example, how you compute the volume, which seems to be always a major problem during the face-to-face, when I was teaching this face-to-face, it was always a problem. What is the volume of this? Why does it use a slanted cylinder? I hope now it is clear why I'm doing that. And so now let's zoom in. Let's only consider this slanted cylinder and let's look at it in 2D, in two dimension, okay? So this surface, basically the cylinder is two surfaces like this, okay, parallel to each other, and then is slanted like this, so there is this angle, okay? Now, instead of showing it in semi-3D like here, I'm gonna look at it from the side, and so I will see two straight lines and two oblique lines, okay? So in particular, let's color code it in a nice way down here. So I'm zooming in 2D, and so in 2D is going to look something like this. Let's see, to keep some space. This should be enough. So this is the section from the side of this area here. So I'm looking at it from the side, so I just see that. So then let me do this length. It looks like this. Okay, great. So this is in 2D. So if you want, for example, here, if this is my interface, Okay, right here, this interface, this is point capital Q. So this point here is capital Q, which is exactly the center of charge here. Okay, so now let me remind you that here actually there is a cross-sectional area, which I'm not showing on the other two sides, just to remind ourselves, this is the same cross-sectional area as that. So this is really my point, my cross, the point Q, to keep the notation consistent. So this one is the normal unit vector n. Is this vector here, it's right there, stemming from the cross. Now, what about, what are these two regions on the left and on the right? These eventually represent the stretching of the Q plus and Q minus, capital Q plus and minus, which are the center charges for the positive and negative charges, respectively. So let's do for the positive charges this color, which is the same as I used in the previous video. So we're going to say that this one is L plus. This is L plus. What about this quantity here? This is the stretching for the negative charges. So this is L minus. And similarly down here, this is L minus and this is L plus. The direction of both L minus and L plus has to be on average, so except for the jittering due to the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution due to finite temperature, has to be both, the direction of this has to be parallel to E naught, so that the L, which is L plus minus L minus, should go exactly as E naught, which is in fact what's happening if I flip around L minus as expected. Now, let us continue the sketch a little bit and let's give some physics meaning to this sketch now. So if I consider, let's say, a positive particle right here, right at this boundary, this interface between the left and the right regions, this, during the polarization process, which is when I switch on E naught, there is a transient, things start to move around, there is dynamics, transient, and so this positive particle, which is close to the interface, will it cross the interface of R delta A? Of course, yes, because it will be stretched away by means of a vector L plus, because I'm polarizing, so this one gets moved by a quantity which is L plus. So we'll end up somewhere in this region. So this charge, which is right at the interface, after a switch on E naught, it will definitely cross that region. This is, in fact, is the first charge to cross, which for sure crosses. What is the last charge, not in time, but in space, the last charge to cross? The last charge in space to cross, obviously, is going to be somewhere here. This is just barely makes it to the interface. So there's to be a tiny bit, an infinitesimal to the right of this interface, and then it's enough, it gets displaced enough to just barely cross. The first and the last to cross in space. Similarly, for the negative particles, this particle here will be the first to cross in space because it's going to go as far as this, which is L minus, so this vector here, all right? And the last to cross, of course, will be, let's say, this particle here, which barely makes it to the interface. Great. So this is the physics of the problem. I don't have any knot, then I switch on any knot, so charges start to move. And so I want to see, I use this interface as a reference, and I want to find how many charges cross this reference frame, this reference interface. The positive charge right at the interface will definitely cross because it gets stretched by L plus. Similarly, the minus one, even more so by L minus because it's larger than L plus in this example. They could be equal sometimes. And these are the last charges to make it through. Okay? So if you understand this concept, then it should be straightforward to find out what is the total charge delta Q plus, which I will do with this color. What is the total charge delta Q plus that makes it through this interface? So how do we compute this quantity? Well, we know that delta Q plus is going to be rho plus in the neighborhood of point capital Q times delta V. But what is delta V now? So I want all the charges that cross this interface, so it's the density of charges, of positive charges there, times the volume of this slanted cylinder, this volume here. The plus volume, so this we can call it delta V plus, if you want, is this orange color here. So I want the density rho plus, I want to find all the positive charges across this interface, which means it's rho plus positive charges times the volume, because we know that all the charges in this volume will cross it. This will cross, this is the last one, this is one of the last ones to cross, this is also one of the last ones to cross. This will definitely cross, this even more definitely will cross. So all those within that volume will cross. So what is delta V plus? Okay, you should stop and think about it for a minute. And so what is delta V plus? Of course, it's the base of this landed cylinder. So if you came back from your thinking, so it's rho plus a point capital Q times the base times the height. The base of the cylinder is delta A, it's clearly this base here. What is the height of a slanted cylinder? Well, basically, we're looking at this quantity here, where this angle is theta. So we want this IH. And so how do we compute H? Well, of course, it has to be L plus times the cosine of theta. But in a more elegant fashion, L plus cosine of theta is nothing but L plus vector, which is this vector here. It forms an angle theta with N, so I just dot it with N. Okay, so this one, it's the charge. So this is the volume, this is delta V plus of this region, of this path of this landed cylinder. That volume times rho plus gives me the charge delta Q plus, which crosses delta A. Great. And so again, you can remind yourself, looking online, there are many resources to find the volume of a slanted cylinder. That's the most elegant way to write it. What about delta Q minus? Delta Q minus, now you should stop and do it yourself. So stop for a minute. And if you came back, you should know that this is rho minus, because I'm looking at the negative charges around Q, times delta V minus, which in this case is rho minus, but rho minus, we know from charge neutrality, the rho minus, now we use it, is minus rho plus. So it's minus rho plus from charge neutrality, which is true also in the case of polarization, around point Q, times this volume, which is going to be delta A times, in this case, L minus dotted with N, because we are looking at the volume in this other side, okay? The negative volume, delta V minus, which is on the other side here of the interface, okay? So L minus dotted with N. Now that we have these two charges, we can sum them up and find the net charge. So the net charge is the summation of these two charges, which is equal to delta Q net. Typically, this actually, we rename it as delta QP for polarization charge. What is this result? Well, it happens to be rho plus, we can factor it out, delta A, we can factor it out. So we have rho plus a point capital Q times delta A, which we can put also on the other side. So we have L plus minus L minus. But what is L plus minus L minus? Well, this is our definition of L vector, as we have seen in one of the first videos. This has to be dotted with N, and delta A, I like to put it on the other side, because the N delta A is basically my oriented surface here, delta A with the orientation N, which is nice, okay? All right, so this means that we can rewrite delta QP as rho plus times L, okay, I drop this Q, this is L by definition, dot N dA, N delta A in this case. But what is rho plus L? Rho plus L is nothing but capital P, the density, the vector polarization, the polarization vector. And so this quantity is nothing but capital P, the polarization vector, dot N delta A. And so now if you go to in the limit, with in a physics limit, so if you perform a physics limit, that is, we go from delta A's to dA's, etc., well, it so happens that we find that dQP, which is the polarization charge, is equal to the flux of P through the area dA, P, then dA. So the flux of the polarization vector P through the area dA gives me the total charge which went through this interface during the polarization process. So this is the result we were looking for. This is part one, because I still didn't connect this with the concept of polarization charge, which is what we are about to do in the next video. So now we will use this concept to explain the idea of polarization charge in the volume, rho P. But this is the basic idea which you need in order to get to that point, okay? And so, to summarize this video, volume polarization charge part one, again, the idea is to study eventually the volume polarization charge rho P, which is more complicated to understand. This is the first part of that. We consider a point Q with an Avogadro number of molecules around that. Local neutrality still applies. Delta V is the volume of this small element here. It has delta Q plus and minus respectively of positive and negative charges calculated by means of density, scalar density in this case. The delta P, which is the dipole moment of that delta V, clearly is the charge times L. As we know, these are quasi-ideal dipoles. I can define a dipole density, and from that I could define sigma P and rho P mathematically, like this. To grasp the physics behind this concept, which we already have seen before, many weeks ago, we consider a slanted cylinder, the lateral surface of which is aligned with the knot, therefore forming with the bases here, which are oriented n, and angle theta, which is very generic. So we do that and we try to investigate during the transient, which is when we switch on a knot, charges start to move around because molecules get polarized. How many of these positive charges will cross this interface and how many negative charges will cross it? And they must cross because, again, I'm changing the molecules effectively. They were non-polar, now they become polar. And so the charge gets displaced, gets moved around, and so it will cross areas. And I want to see if I use this reference area, how much they cross. This is what we get, these two charges, positive and negative. The net charge, of course, is summation of the two, which is, of course, non-zero, is given by P dot NDA, where P is given by rho plus L. And remember that even if these two vectors are exactly the same, they're opposite of each other, so the sum, the difference is not going to be zero, okay? And in the physics limit, this clearly gives us that DQP is P dot NDA. We're going to use this now, in the next video, to understand the concept of rho P. That's it.